What a long, great trip it's been. That was my Jerry Garcia. Welcome to the top 10. We've been on a fantastic journey looking at the top 100 in this sale. Again, so hard, so unique, so different, but it's to showcase how great this sale is, and I think we've done that. I hope you've stayed with us throughout this and continue to put up with me and listen to me as we rip through these guns just to show off the uniqueness and greatness of this sale. Without further ado, let's get into the top 10 and have some fun. Breaking into the top 10, we have number 10. It is lot number 1106. That is lot number 1106. Another treat, another great gun, another well-pedigreed gun, and it's quick to see, and that's why we'll explain. It is number 10 on our list from the legendary McCroskey collection. We talked about the pair of Squareback 51 Navies, also from the McCroskey collection. Here's another treasure from that collection. Again, a Colt. You think McCroskey, you think Winchester. Not the case. He collected great 19th century American firearms. Now, the best collections built over the last century have been diversified. They've been Colts, they've been Winchesters, Remington, Smith & Wessons. It's diversity, but it's one rule. Don't discriminate against greatness. Do not discriminate against a great gun. And number 10 is this 1860 factory engraved, carved ivory, gripped and cased 1860 Army revolver from the McCroskey collection. Now, if you study factory engraved Colts, if you collect factory engraved percussion Colts specifically, the 1860 model is the most difficult to obtain. And that is because the U.S. Ordnance Department ordered approximately 125,000 during the American Civil War. They took up most of the production from 1861 through 1865. And so you don't see factory engraved examples often. And when you do, normally they don't have any finish. They were actually used alongside their counterparts that were either ordered by the government or just taken to war with them because it was the most popular sidearm of the American Civil War. And so factory engraved examples are few and far between. What's also neat about this gun is that it is fresh. It is a very fresh gun. I mean, you can count on one or two hands, maybe a few fingers on the other hand, how many 1860s, factory engraved 1860s, are actually worth owning, let alone our wartime production guns. Because this gun was manufactured in 1863, so it's a peak Civil War production gun, and the fact that it was factory engraved, again, carved ivory grips and case, that's what makes it so rare. And then it's condition. But it's also a nuanced gun because, you know, as Larry Wilson coined the term late vine scroll engraving. So we see this transition in factory engraved percussion Colts in approximately 1861. He calls it late, but from 1861 to 1870, we get into the cartridge era, but the style of the engraving patterns themselves change, and they call it that late vine scroll. I mean, what you see is essentially they drop using the backgrounds. You don't see the punch dot background virtually anymore. And then that's why this is a nuanced gun, because it is not of that late vine scroll engraving. It is your classic large scroll and punch dot, very, very, very well done, but it's a condition example. And again, of the known factory engraved 1860s, rarely do you find one in any condition. And we talked about back straps before, but using logic, whether it was 50 years ago, 60 years ago, or 150 years ago, when someone goes to grab a firearm, of course they grab the back strap first. And you can see this gun's been really handled very, very little. And a tremendous amount of original blue on the back strap itself. Any finish loss on this gun is purely flaking. It's time lost. It is not use lost. I'll just roll it a little bit and you can see the brilliance of the case hardening on the loading gate itself. Beautiful, beautiful full cylinder scene. You can see the brilliance of the bluing on the frame, on the cylinder. I'll flip it around. You can see the brilliance of the hammer. I mean, this gun is all there. And there's just enough flaking on it to keep it honest. Another rare feature are the factory carved patriotic ivory grips. I mean, very, very, very rare. It's got a beautiful casing, beautiful accessories. It's an as found, as sold, as issued gun. I mean, this gun has stayed together. The casing, the flash, the mold, everything has stayed together from when it was originally sold in 1863. As the old adage goes, if a gun could talk, I mean, this gun was special. This gun was important. And that's why it's number 10 on our list, because they are so, so, so rare. So if you're in the market, if you collect extremely fine factory engraved Colts, extremely fine factory engraved percussion Colts, you know it's very, very difficult to find an example worthy of your collection. Here it is, number 10 on our list, number 1106 in the catalogs. N- Number 9 on our list is lot number 266. That is lot number 266. And as we get down into the twilight of this tour, of this journey, we're going to get the opportunity to bring some stuff full circle, which is what we're going to do here with this single action. So we've got to see the last Winchester 1897 shotgun, the last Winchester 1873 rifle, the gun that won the West. We've seen the first serial number 1 Winchester Model 42. We've seen serial number 1 Winchester Model 12. And to bring it full circle, let's talk about the last factory engraved first generation Colt single action. And I want to talk about how rare this gun is, how neat this gun is. And I have a theory, right, wrong, or indifferent, that I want to discuss with this gun. So what we have, this is serial number 357,689. That's 357,689. We sold a gun, 4 or 5 years ago. It was 357,600, just 600 even. And that was thought to be the last factory engraved single action, the highest known documented example. That was a 357, 7.5-inch blue case hardened gun. And now we have this gun pop up, 357,689. Now, when we observe first generation, that is from 1873 through the end of production in 1941, that is what we consider first generation Colt single actions, they list the final production number as 357,869. And again, this is 689. Now, I can only give you perspective, and I've done some research on this, but I went back through our records and I said, okay, what's the highest first generation single action that we've sold? Well, The one thing we have to discuss are the pre-war, post-war guns. So Colt, after World War II, they put together 300 guns out of first-generation parts. These are known as pre-war, post-war guns. They made 300 of them. We have sold 7 pre-war, post-war guns that are a lower serial number than this. So what does that mean? We have lower serial number documented sales that were not shipped from Colt until 1947. Okay, so that's the rarefied air. That's how rare this is. Let's also talk about Lend-Lease. You don't think about that too much when you think about Colt single actions, but in the Lend-Lease, you have Great Britain who orders 163 single actions. Now, these are known as Battle of Britain guns. We actually have one in the sale. And again, depth of this sale, we have a Battle of Britain gun in the sale. So of the last guns, you have 163 of them that were shipped to Britain as Battle of Britain guns. So I want to talk again about this serial number, 357,689, and the last known number is 357,869, or that's what they tell us. How easy would it have been for them to transpose those two numbers, the 6 and the 8? Again, this is serial number 357,689. The last one they list is 357,869. It's two numbers. And I can't find a first generation single action that shipped prior to 41 or in 41 that is higher than this one. And that's my theory, crazy, right, wrong, or indifferent. Could this very well be the last first generation Colt single action? Absolutely. Why not? Is it the last factory engraved first generation Colt single action? I could say without fear of contradiction that we believe it is. And so we've just established the rarity of this gun, that it is the last factory engraved first generation Colt single action. And we haven't discussed the most important part, which is the fact that it is just flat brand new. And in the catalog description, we said near mint. I have to tell you, it's a technicality. I mean, this gun is virtually mint. We have a hard time saying it's mint. There are a few minor, minute flaws or flakes on this gun that keep it honest. Other than that, it is absolutely brand spanking factory new. This gun shipped October of 1941. So think about that. As Colt's gearing up, tooling up for World War II, which was imminent in 41, especially in October of 41, we're like 45 days from the day of infamy, which is December 7th, 1941, when Japan decides to bomb Pearl Harbor and we enter World War II. We're 45 days removed from that, and this gun ships in October of 1941. That is how late this gun is. Again, it is absolutely flat mint. It's a Class C engraved, which means it's a full coverage gun. Full coverage from the muzzle of the barrel all the way down the grip strap. Plasti by Glahn, again, and it's as good as it gets. Now, it also letters to an absolute T, 7.5-inch factory engraved. It says Plasti in the letter itself. It was shipped as a one-gun special order to a sporting goods store in Pennsylvania. It's accompanied by an S.D. Meyer El Paso tooled holster. It is fresh, fresh, fresh. It is great, great, great. That is why it is number 9 on our list. What an opportunity to own the last factory engraved mint Colt first generation single action Army revolver. Number 8 on our list, lot number 1015. That is lot number 1015. These are the types of guns that I live for. These are the types of guns that drive my passion in this field, is to observe again the best of the best, the finest of the finest, exquisite, high art, important, well pedigree, well known, well provenance guns. And that is what we have in this iconic Winchester relief engraved 1866 rifle. Condition alone, fabulous gun, high relief, ultra high relief, gilt frame. And I'll leave it there because I want to talk about a few things. When I first saw this gun, we've had the privilege and opportunity to handle some exceptional Winchesters, probably the best Winchesters, particularly at auction. We've handled them, and I personally had that opportunity and blessed to have done so, and that's why I do love this stuff, getting hands-on with them. When I saw this gun, so it's signed. Got to find the signature on this gun. Now, it's not uncommon for the Ulrichs. You look at, say, Ulrich engraved, and that's the thing. When this gun's photographed in the 1971 Arms Annual, both editions of Winchester engraving, and it's always attributed to John Ulrich. Well, they signed their work, no doubt about it. So let's find the signature. I mean, again, it wasn't uncommon for the Ulrichs to hide their signature, kind of camouflage them. In fact, in a number of guns that we've sold and that we've seen, you'll see 6, 7, 8, 9, 10 signatures that are hidden, and sometimes in plain sight, which is frustrating because you have that light bulb aha moment and you see it, and then you see another one and another one and another one. You say, how did I miss this? I've stared at this gun for 2 hours. Well, So I had my first sit with this gun. I called it a sit, and I'm just staring at it, enjoying it, looking at it, studying it, understanding it. Can't find a signature anywhere. Flip it around, stare at it. Richard Ellis and I, he did the same thing. He took it, sat down with it for an hour or two, stared at it, enjoyed it, loved it, looked at it. Couldn't find a signature. Now it becomes a challenge. We're like, it's got to be here. It's got to be there. So we're looking in the relief panel scene. Sometimes you'll see it on the lip. Sometimes, again, it's just right there in front of you, but you miss it. So I've probably had 3 or 4 hours, and Richard spent some good time looking at this gun. And finally, I said, let's pull the stock. Let's pull the stock and see what we find, because we have seen signatures under the stock. Pull the stock, we're looking, we don't see anything at first glance. Roll it over, and there is a very, very fine hand-signed HLU. Bingo, lights go off, fireworks are going, because this is a very important discovery. And the gun's been known since the 70s, obviously, but it's never before been described properly. It's never before been discussed properly. And what we have is Conrad Frederick Ulrich. It's the greatest engraving dynasty. You have Conrad Frederick Ulrich. You have John Ulrich, but there was also a middle brother, which is Herman Leslie Ulrich, and that is that HLU signature. Now, it's known, it's discussed in books, and they talk about the Ulrichs as an engraving dynasty, but they also say, and Wilson, to quote him directly, says there are no masterpieces known by Herman Leslie Ulrich. Quite frankly, we've never sold another Herman Leslie Ulrich gun. Doing some research, I have found a few guns attributed to Herman Leslie Ulrich. And I say attributed because that HLU can't be Herman Leslie Ulrich. I don't know who it is, but you can see the quality here. We've never had one, we've never seen one. So we get to unveil this as, and for the first time and properly, Herman Leslie Ulrich's masterpiece, the relief engraved Winchester 1866 rifle. To take it a step further, going back to the 70s, 1971 Arms Annual, and of course the first and second book of Winchester engraving, they attribute this gun and several others to the 1876 Philadelphia Centennial Display. Now, when we think of the 1876 Philadelphia Centennial Display, my mind, as I'm sure many of yours, goes to the famous pinwheel Colt single action board. Well, Winchester also had a display, so we start doing some research, digging. Talk to Cody, they can't find anything. They gave us a few breadcrumbs. Well, we did find one photo. It's taken from above, looking down on the American manufacturers at the 1876. You can see the rampant Colt, and then you can see Winchester's display. And In the small, littlest glimpse of a window, you can see about four or five rifles, which appear to be 66s. You can't see engraving, there's no serial number list, there's nothing, but they appear to be 66s. So this gun has always been attributed to the Philadelphia Centennial. The gun at Cody has always been attributed to the Philadelphia Centennial. And they're right in the same serial number range. I mean, they're all right there. And I think 1871, they're all manufactured in 1871, kept as apparently factory display pieces and then put on display at the Centennial. But what a gun we have here, what a privilege it is. So if you're, it's a nuance. If you collect factory engraved Winchesters, if you collect best quality 19th century American firearms, here's the sensational, phenomenal, kind of a once in a lifetime, first of, and probably only opportunity to own a Herman Leslie Ulrich masterpiece, simply because there are no other ones known, certainly no other ones signed. He must have cut others, obviously, but find another signature, find another relief engraved 1866 with this much gilding and the depth of it. And that was again, kind of the light bulb for us. Stylistically, very similar, but once we found the HLU, you see nuanced differences. So for the first time, and again, a privilege to present it, we have number 8, which is lot number 1015 in your catalogs, the Herman Leslie Ulrich relief engraved 1866 masterpiece. Number 7 on our list is lot number 1362. That is lot number 1362 from the legendary collection of Robert M. Lee out of his best quality sporting and shotgun collection, which is just a fantastic grouping of guns. Actually, that were just on display. There was an exhibition done at the Nevada Museum of Art, the Robert M. Lee collection of magnificent and beautiful sporting arms. So this is from Mr. Lee's collection, as well as the other three guns that make up this set. So it is 4 best quality by Holland & Holland dangerous game rifles. The set was originally commissioned in 1985 by hunter, collector, conservationist William Feldstein. And how it was commissioned and why it's commissioned is what makes the set so valuable and important, and why I picked this of the 4 guns to be the one that I talked to you about. Mr. Feldstein went to Holland & Holland and said, I want to do a set of rifles, and I want the largest of the battery to be a 600 Nitro. Well, Holland said, sir, we built the last 600 Nitro approximately a decade ago. By tradition, it was relayed to me that Holland had a great client, and he commissioned a 600 Nitro in the mid-70s, and he wanted it to be the last 600. I'm sure there was some money involved, some politicking, and Holland agreed. And so when Mr. Feldstein, who was a great client of Holland at the time, went to him and said, I want to do a 600, they said, we can't do that, sir. He said, okay, well, what's bigger? Well, a 700 Nitro. So this is the development. So before me right here, and what we're offering in the sale, is the first 700 Nitro Express made by Holland & Holland. They say there's approximately 15 known. We believe it's to be far fewer than that they actually made. And it's part of a set. So starting with number 1, we have a 375 H&H, and then there's a 465. Little brother to the 700 is a 577 Nitro. And then of course we have this magnificent and gargantuan specimen, the 700 Nitro. Now, All the rifles are engraved by Alan Brown. He needs little introduction as an absolute master. 4 British sporting arms, 4 best quality long arms. Brown brothers are known as the best. They are the best. And so all the work on all 4 rifles is done by Alan Brown. Now, it's called the African series, the African game series, because when Mr. Feldstein went to Holland, he said, make it an ode to the Dark Continent. And that's what we have. And so all of the panel scenes are actually taken from sketches, mostly from Gordon Cummings' book, A Hunter's Life. So all the scenes are different. They illustrate a story from Gordon Cummings' career, which is fantastic and phenomenal. And you look at some of the scenes and they look a little strange. It's because they are copies of those original sketches. And so the 375, the 465, the 577, and then again this beautiful specimen, this big gargantuan monster 700, all those scenes are featured from Gordon Cummings' book. And they are beautiful, they are powerful, they are elegant, they are aggressive, they are extremely important. It is why this is number 7 on our list. The first Holland & Holland 700 Nitro, complete with a 3-gun battery that will be offered as 1 lot. Again, that's number 7 on our list, number 1362 in your catalogs. Number six on our list, lot number 1475. That's Super Bowl Saturday. You can see how potent Saturday of this sale is going to be. We've talked about the 45 caliber pistol test, the 1907 test of the 45 ACP. So we have the privilege and the opportunity to have a 1907 on our list, a 1909 on our list, and then the real, true, unbelievable holy grail, which is the 1910 prototype. And I said the 1909, that was the third example that we've sold. For a 1910, just to put it into perspective for you, we sold one. It's kind of an asterisk, and we called it as it was. It was assembled from parts, so some original 1910 parts, some not original parts, and it was also refinished. And I believe that gun brought $50,000 or $60,000 in 2009, 2010. So we've never offered a fully original 1910 prototype trials pistol, test pistol. So that is why I proudly present it to you, and that is why it is deserving of our list to be number six. It is a holy grail for U.S. pistol collectors, U.S. automatic collectors, and automatic collectors in general. And that's where it transcends from the military application to collectors of automatic pistols. And it was an improvement on the 1909. And what did they do? Well, they kept refining. They kept making it just a little bit better, just a little bit better. The one of the things that everybody goes to and everybody points to is the grip angle. It went from an 84 degree grip angle to a 74 degree. So they changed it by 10 degrees. And then they just worked on the improvements, most notably on that barrel lug itself. They were still having problems cracking blocks, cracking slides with that pressure. They went from the lug on the barrel, the two lugs on the barrel going all the way around the barrel to just going off on the top. And that was an important improvement. John Browning recognized the pressure was too great and timing was off. There was too much pressure on the timing. So it's improvement, small improvement, small improvement, small improvement. This is serial number two. Now there's like, number two is known, number four is known, number five is known, and I'm probably missing one or two, but truly there are less than five or six 1910 prototypes known. Now, don't get it confused with the 1910 9.8, the baby. We did sell one of those, but this is a 45 ACP. It's not the 9.8. It is the first original 1910 that we will be offering. I don't know when the last time one of these hit the market. It is such an opportunity, and you only get one shot. A fleeting moment, a fleeting opportunity. Serial number two, Colt 1910 prototype, direct predecessor to the 1911. Number five on our list is lot number 108, and you could see what a humbling task this has been. I had to rank those swords, had to rate all this stuff, and this is the sword I picked. Out of the three that we've talked about, probably the finest grouping of swords Rock Island Auctions ever cataloged or offered. I get the question a lot, what's the coolest item, what's the most historic item that you've ever sold? I always go to the Theodore Roosevelt hunting knife that we sold several years ago because the history was great, presented to our 26th president on his last day in office, gold and platinum, and the history was phenomenal, and we got to meet members of the Roosevelt family. This is going to go down probably as number two for favorite objects that I've been around, favorite objects that we've sold, strictly for the history itself. We did a separate video on that. I encourage you to watch it. But it's, again, it's a Tiffany sword, a non-regulation pattern, but it was presented to Colonel Frick, Colonel Jacob Frick, by his men on Thanksgiving Day of 1862. Three short weeks later, we have the Battle of Fredericksburg, where Colonel Frick is cited and where he is the recipient of the Medal of Honor. He was a Medal of Honor recipient, and that is the battle that he won. And the neatest part about this ensemble is not only the spectacular condition and beauty and rarity of this Tiffany sword, but it's actually the cane that sits right in front of it and is accompanied in this archival lot. The inscription on the cane presented by his men reads, "To Colonel Frick, 129th Regiment, Pennsylvania Volunteers, part of the flagstaff shot off in his hands while leading his regiment in the final charge on the rebel works at the Battle of Fredericksburg, Virginia, December 13th, 1862. It's also appropriate to read his Medal of Honor citation. The President of the United States of America, in the name of Congress, takes pleasure in presenting the Medal of Honor to Colonel Jacob G. Frick, United States Army, for his extraordinary heroism on the 13th of December, 1862, while serving the 129th Pennsylvania Infantry in action at Fredericksburg, Virginia. Colonel Frick seized the colors and led the command through a terrible fire of cannon and musketry." And so, and as we have, the citations are wonderful, the inscriptions are wonderful, but here, holding it, is this wonderful piece of American history. I mean, a national treasure-worthy piece, a national treasure-worthy archive, and that is the beauty of our field. We can touch this, we can own this. So important, and that's why, I mean, it's pretty obvious, and we've got to handle some great stuff. This will go down as number two on my list for incredibly historic goosebumps that you get to be able to see this stuff and live this stuff and understand the passion, the tradition, and the history. So without hesitation, I put this as number five on my list and number 108 in the catalogs. Number four, we go to lot number 1096. That's lot number 1096, and it's always a thrill, always a privilege to talk about a Colt Walker, and that is what we have for you. We could always associate Walkers, of course, with Texas as they were issued to the first mounted rifles, the Texas Rangers, the original Texas Rangers, if you will, and I won't go into the story of Samuel Colt or Samuel Walker and the development of. I want to just talk about this specific gun. We did do a video on it, so check it out. I have to mention it. It's the most historic Walker that we're aware of. We sent it off and had it evaluated by a Walker expert, Herb Glass Jr. He did a great write-up on it, and him and I got to have a conversation about this gun at the Las Vegas Antiques Arm Show. I mean, he was reminiscing. He said, that's just got to be the damned most historic Walker there is. I mean, and it really is. And he was like, I wish I would have put a little more in my letter, but it is as good a gun as it gets. It's as fresh a gun as it gets. And Mr. Glass's write-up, I think he identified three or four replacement screws, as well as just the retention on the loading lever as a replacement. Other than that, it is totally original and authentic. What is normally replaced, and with Walkers, you know, we'll take some parts as original. Not the case here. Again, it's just the screw and the spring itself. The loading lever assembly is totally original. The cylinder, interestingly enough, is a mismatch. It's C Company 208. So when the Walkers were issued, it went C Company, which was Samuel Walker's company, then A, B, D, and E. And the first three companies, C, A, and B, those are the guns that were issued and saw action with the first mounted Texas rifles, the Texas Rangers. And as the story goes, you know, they used to clean their cylinders in the big pots of boiling water at night, and they weren't worried about matching the cylinders back up with their original gun. And so I think that kind of adds to this gun, personally, as being a C Company cylinder. Now, as it relates to South Texas history, the gun was discovered in 1996 by a very well-known and celebrated South Texas collector. And again, it was discovered in South Texas through the Darst family, which is a fourth-generation Texan pioneer family, which means a whole hell of a lot. You know, the Darst family is there, you know, 15 years before Samuel Walker, and the descendant who owned this gun and sold it to this collector, you know, her great-great-grandfather rode with John Austin, was at the Battle of San Jacinto, actually guarded Santa Ana after they captured him. Her great-grandfather rode in the 8th Texas Cavalry. The 8th Texas was required to furnish their own weapons, furnish their own revolvers, bring their own long arms. You know, it's not unreasonable to consider that the only time that this Walker has been out of South Texas is when it went to fight in the American Civil War, again, as our friends down south say, the War of Northern Aggression. And it just passed down and passed down through the family. You know, and her great-great-uncle was killed at the Alamo. It's an unbelievable piece of Texas history in the Darst family, and having this gun go down and down and down and down through. And it's accompanied by documentation, a letter of affidavit as such, and also accompanied by an equally rare, of course not an original issued holster, but this holster has been with this gun a very, very long time. You do not see holsters for Walkers, particularly one that is as unique and original to the gun as you could hope for. They age together. And, you know, when Mr. Glass said he was taking the gun apart, he said, this thing, it's just as found. It is what it is, because there was so much crud and buildup in all the parts. And that's exactly what you want in one of these guns. That's why it's number four on our list. It is the most historic 1847 Colt Walker known, and certainly a national treasure, specifically of the Lone Star State, as good as it gets for Texas history, as rare as it gets for an antique collectible firearm. Number four on our list, number 1096 in the catalog. Number three on our list is lot number 81 in your catalogs. We're getting down to it, the top three. Whew. And what we have is a unbelievably fresh, previously unknown, and we talk about freshness. This thing just reeks of it. Colt 1839 carbine. Now, we actually had one of these guns in our last sale in December from the Robert M. Lee collection, a presentation 1839 carbine example that did extraordinarily well. And we were calling that gun the finest. And this is the unknown. When something totally fresh gets kicked out of the brush that is previously unrecorded, unknown, undiscovered, well, this is the case in this 39 carbine. And what you'll see immediately is this sling bar here on the left side, which should stick out or might stick out to you outside of its obvious condition and freshness. And so when we, just for a condition standpoint, when we're evaluating Patterson's, much like Walker's, any minute original finish, whether it be a small protected area, perhaps 10%, 20%, 30%, that is you're in great category. So the condition of this gun, you're looking at 80% overall with the majority of the finish loss on the barrel, because the cylinder's spectacular, the frame's wonderful, the case hardening's outrageous. So with an 80% on the barrel, it's just enough to keep it so honest. I want to talk a little bit about the history of this gun, because when something this good comes out of nowhere, it shocks you. And I kind of obsessed over this thing for a little bit, because where was this gun? What's the story on it? Tell me about the sling bar. There's more than meets the eye here. Where was it? What is it? And so I started doing some research. I did quite a bit of research on this gun myself. And we have to reference, go back to Philip R. Phillips' book, Patterson Variations. And reading through that, they have an unbelievable archive of letters from the Patent Arms Manufacturing Company. We go back to the U.S. Ordnance Department ordering 100 Colt 1839 Patterson carbines. And the thing you have to understand is during these military contracts, this carbine was competing with the 1842, 1843 Hall carbine. I mean, so they were seeking a cavalry carbine. Going through all that documentation, they have to mention the Halls have a sling bar. You'll see that, and some of them actually have a saddle ring. So they have to reference this. So we find a letter, and let me also say that 100 gun procurement by the U.S. Ordnance Department was done in March of 1841. So we find a letter. I find a letter in the back of the book dated March 29th, 1841. And they're discussing the delivery of the 100 carbines to the Ordnance Department. And they state, if it was the superintendent of patent firearms manufacturing at the time, and he says, if we are to furnish the carbines with slides, I would recommend that we defer the inspection 1 week hence. Later on, Philip R. Phillips and Wilson go on to state that no such known 39 carbines with a slide bar or sling bar are known to date. And again, it brings up more questions than answers, because unfortunately, there are no known 1839 U.S. Ordnance accepted 39 carbines. They're not known. Unless they weren't cartouched, they weren't marked. There are no known examples. What we have here is really, what is it? Is it the inspection model that they submitted? Is it one of the military submitted carbines? We don't know. But what we do know is that it's absolutely fantastic. It is absolutely fresh, and that is great history, great story, great provenance to back it up. The 39 carbines were the most successful, and I just want to roll it around and show you the condition. We talk about like a damn near mint cylinder. It is a damn near mint cylinder. The case hardening is not good. It is not great. It is absolutely brilliant on the guard and on the bottom of the frame too. I also want to show the butt as well, because you can see brilliant case hardening on that butt, and just a little bit of oxidation in the middle, which is, you know, it just tells more about the gun, a little better story on the gun, because as far as Patterson's goes, you could consider this thing near mint for cumulative rarity. It's why it's number 3 on the list. It is as good as it gets, as rare as it gets, as fresh as it gets, and what an opportunity it is. Number 3 on our list, number 81 in your catalogs. Number 2 on our list is number 15 in your catalogs. That's Friday morning. What a lineup we have for you early Friday morning for rarity, condition, importance. But this is, I can say without fear of contradiction, the most important long arm that we've ever sold. It's not going to go down. It probably won't go down as the most expensive long arm ever sold. But it is the most important, because it is the genesis of the lever action rifle, which means so much to repeating firearms. It's courtesy of the Dr. Gerald Klaas collection. This was the cornerstone of Dr. Klaas's collection for Smith & Wesson's, for Volcanics. It was truly his pride and joy, and for good reason. We talk about the history of this gun again in another video, but it's so important because you have this partnership between D.B. Wesson and Horace Smith. They really bring repeating firearms to the forefront. Others had tried, but we have this initial run. We have the number one pistol, the number two pistol, and then this rifle. Obviously, they go defunct. It turns into the Volcanic Repeating Arms Company, later the New Haven Arms Company, later Winchester. Okay, so right at that crucial break between Smith & Wesson, when Oliver Winchester gets involved in the Volcanic Repeating Arms Company, they produced this rifle. They said they produced 10, or the books say they produced 10. There's three known. This is the only example of a lever-action Smith & Wesson rifle, or carbine, as this one is. Known. There's only three known. It's the only one in private hands. There's the big 50 calibers at the Cody Museum. There's another one, I believe, at an institution in Milwaukee. This is the only one, and it's also the finest of the three that are known. But it's the first lever-action repeating rifle or carbine. It seems simple, but we have this German silver inlay on the left side, and we have the shaking of hands. It's the partnership of D.B. Wesson and Horace Smith. It's the celebration of this rifle, of repeating firearms, but it's memorialized on this gun forever. It's factory engraved. It's ultra deluxe. The engineering, the machining is absolutely phenomenal, and it's very subtle in terms of the engraving itself, but again, the silver on the stock. My favorite angle on this gun, if we can get it on the camera, is we look at the top tang here, but then we go to the hammer. We see that tremendous amount of original case hardening on the hammer itself, but then if we look at the face of the frame where the hammer meets the frame, it's this, you know, it's that flash, it's that explosion. It's a beautiful, beautiful touch. I also love the engraving on the lever itself. Like I said, it's subtle, but it's important. And they knew this gun was deluxe. They knew it was important. And to speak to its importance, you have to look at the pedigree of it. So it was maintained by the Wesson family. It was sold in 1975, and it went boom, 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 boom. So it was sold in 1975 by the Wesson family. It went to Abercrombie & Fitch. Alan Kelly bought this gun, as well as there's a pistol grip carbine that will be coming up in a future sale, part of Dr. Klaas's collection as well. So there's two guns that came right from the Wesson family. He buys them from Abercrombie & Fitch and sells them to noted Smith & Wesson collector Calhoun Norton. When Mr. Norton passed away in 1981, Dr. Klaas acquired this gun and several others from Mr. Norton's collection. But it was his pride and joy. It's the best of the best, and it's for good reason. The genesis, the birth of lever-action firearms, the birth of Winchester, and so much more. Number two on our list, number 15 in your catalogs. What a gun, what a gun. We made it to number one on our list. Without further ado, I present lot number 1316. Lot 1316 that will be sold Saturday. And what a pair of guns we have. We did a special historic video on these guns, which I encourage everybody to watch. And I kind of want to set the tone. I don't think this has to be too long. I'll use other people's words, not mine, at first. When we had these guns on display at Las Vegas, at the Las Vegas Antiques Arms Show, we had generations of fine arms dealers and fine arms collectors with a combined knowledge base that is literally centuries. And they had the same reaction to these pistols that when I saw them for the first time, that when many people do for the first time. It's emotional, it's wonderful, it's spectacular, but it lights you up and it stops you, and you know you are in the presence of something not only incredibly important, but incredibly beautiful, and that's what these pistols are. Using their words, they said, "These are the finest pistols I have ever seen. They are the finest pistols in private circulation, available for the public to own." I couldn't agree anymore. They are matched in beauty by their history, but they are, as far as I am concerned, the finest pair of boutés in private circulation for a pair of pistols. Made by Nicolas Noel Boutte, arms maker to Louis XVI and Napoleon Bonaparte. These guns are, and they're so atypical for Boutte's, just in terms, we've talked about form when we look at high art European guns. Their form is particularly English. Normally you see a more dramatic bend on the grip, and the decorations atypical for bouteilles in the bluing on the lock, but not only the use of gold, but the amount of gold. They are essentially encrusted in gold and varying types of gold. They were presented in 1808 to Admiral Cesar Bourrienne. He was a phenomenal figure. He tells a story that is not only an American story, a success story, but it's about people. He rose from nothing to become something. He was appointed by Napoleon Bonaparte to be Baron of the Empire in approximately 1810, but his history starts long before then. A deckhand at the age of 7. He fought in the American Revolution, of course, on a French ship at the Battle of Yorktown. So there's a unique American tie here. He went on to fight. He died in his mid-40s, but he fought essentially his entire life. He fought his entire life at sea and in every ocean and sea that you can think of. These particular pistols were presented to him again in 1808 by the traders of Mauritius for him defeating the Mauritius had a blockade on their port. Admiral Bourrienne defeated the HMS Lory and for their gratitude, they presented these pistols to him. And they bear his crest on the grip. And they are just, they're so good. They're so important. They never get old to look at. You can look at them every time and see something new and they grow. They really do grow. I want to show the butt of the pistols here. And typically guns of this nature, this ultra high art degree, they tell a story, and a lot of bouteilles tell a story. Talk about hidden signatures and hidden meanings on bouteille, but quite obvious and apparent. We have Poseidon on the butt, clearly a nautic or naval theme going on. We can see seashells here on the butt as well, but beautiful mounts, bluing, and then the gold is something to be seen. Again, and using other people's words, not mine, I'm gonna tilt it so we can see the gold on that side. And other people's words, not mine, the finest pair of pistols in private circulation. These will be offered on Saturday afternoon. Quite apparently, you can see why they are number one on the list. As good as it gets, absolutely as good as it gets, and you don't have to press your face up against museum glass to see them. They are worthy of the most prestigious public institution. They are an absolute tour de force, the magnum opus of bouteilles. You know, here's your shot. These guns could bring any amount of money. We have them estimated at $300,000 to $500,000, I believe. If they brought $1 million or $2 million, it's very simple. The next time they are for sale, you ask for more money. They are that good. They are in a class of their own. And that's really the problem with these guns is finding comparables. You know, you see comparables for bouteilles at $200,000 and $250,000, and then the ceiling is raised. And then you don't have comparables on bouteilles until $1 million, $1.2 million, $2 million. Of course, there's pairs of bouteilles that have been said to have traded for $5 million, $10 million, even $12 million. But here's your shot in a very public setting. You don't have to pay what somebody tells you have to pay. They are as good, they're as good as anything. Absolutely as good as anything. And I'm talking about other art objects, fine art, paintings, automobiles, sports memorabilia. Here's just an immense and fleeting opportunity to own the best. It's very clear, number one on our list, these absolutely fabulous magnum opus bouteilles. I've had a blast doing this. I hope you guys have enjoyed it as well. Our top 100 look at our upcoming premier firearms auction, the sale of the century, a very, very, very important auction.